Hi guys, only me. This is a bit of a technical test as well. I'm trying to work out whether this mobile phone is actually taking the input from this microphone. I'll find out in due course. So I could be doing a lot of talking and achieving absolutely nothing in this video. You never know. Such is life. And I'm still coming down a bit from the quite intense activity these last few months of both doing the day job with the heavy commute and working on the books, and I'm still just chilling out, coming back down to speed. Deep breaths, inner peace, inner peace. You know what it's been like. I wanted to, there's a bit of a dead spot between when I get to work and start the job of about half an hour to an hour, and I normally use that to browse the websites, the news, get myself up to date on what's been going on lately. And there is still a very intense argument raging about man, woman, male, female, transsexual, transgender, and I don't really want to get involved in the discussion as such because, there's still a lot of people coming to the table and they've got no intention of exposing themselves to the danger that their own viewpoint might be changed. Oh no, they're there at the table purely to impose their viewpoint on everyone else. And in some discussions, there's a lot of very intense language, shall I say, being used, and nobody's really getting to the nub of the matters. Nobody seems to be making any progress in those kinds of discussions. People seem to be still arguing over definitions of things. So I thought there's a few things that I'd want to get out there. There are people who are saying that no matter how much surgery, nothing will make a man a woman or a woman a man. Now, to a fair degree, they've got a point. But here's the nub of it. If you take a man and a woman and they're involved in a pretty serious road accident, they're decapitated at the waist down, and it also in the woman's case also it winds up with mastectomy for some reason, and they're both sitting there. Does their physical condition make them any more or less the woman or man that they were before the accident? I think most people will say no, they are still the woman and the man that they were. And you can take that one step forward, one step further to the Futurama universe and the heads in jars concept, and also the book Heads. I've forgotten who wrote it, I've got it in my book library somewhere, I'll have to dig it out. But even in the case of the heads that are in the jars, you still have the personality there. You're still able to identify. I think they actually do the Star Trek cast more often than anything. And also some of the politicians. Nixon, even Nixon's head, you still identify Nixon's head as male, and Spock's as male, and Uhura's as female. And also Kirk's. Do they do Kirk's very often? I don't know. But that speaks plainly that man and woman goes far, goes beyond physical embodiment. And we know such. What it is that makes a man and a woman is not the physical body, it's the personality. And the traits that make up that person. It's much easier in this world. One of the things we do, as a matter of human course, is, and indeed, what seems to be the unconscious, or one of the factors, unconscious factors, underlying discrimination, is that when we want someone to do a particular job or whatever the rest, we do the job that We want someone to do the job as we would want to do it, as we would want it done. So we choose someone unconsciously or subconsciously who looks like us, however we look, because we have the assumption that they will have the same values as us, have the same background as us, has the same history as us, have the same viewpoints as us, and thus handle things in the same way that we would want to handle them. And that's a fallacy. In a bus, I can be sat next to two people, one who looks identically like me and one who looks pretty much as opposite to me. You know what I'm saying? And it can turn out that the person who looks most like me can have completely opposite political views, different tastes in music, different tastes in film, reading material, and and the person who looks most different from me can hold the same political viewpoints, like the same sort of music, read the same sort of books, you know. And I think that's one of the most important things about the foundations of discrimination, because discrimination happens pretty much everywhere among all segments of society, male, female, different races, whatever. But there was something else, and that is, it's been said that in Hollywood, a number of the major decision makers who determine what material is bought and put on our screens. I think they were saying Meryl Streep, I think, was on video, and the main ten were all male. Now, to a degree, having women on that in that arena will probably help. It'll help some issues, and diversity in that field will also help, because it'll help crack that one of those foundation blocks of discrimination. But it won't automatically solve a lot of the stuff. Having women as those decision makers, just as the men have been biased towards one way, the women can be biased towards another way. And having the person needs to, whoever it is, needs to, in that job, needs to have an empathy with the entire range of audience. Case in point, what Fox did when they moved from sci-fi to sci-fi. I think I've forgotten the names, but this happened a while ago. And there was a man and a woman heading up the team that was making the transition and deciding what would go on and all the rest of it, because they put wrestling on a sci-fi channel. Huge hoo-ha. But Caprica got canned, you know, and that's despite having a gender equivalent panel in charge of the show, you know, in charge of the whole Fox thing, the sci-fi channel. And, you know, the woman seems to have got the same sort of viewpoint and the same sort of material likings as the man. That's what I read at the time. I've forgotten the names. I've tried. If I find the link, I'll put it in the hoo-ha bar. that's one of the problems for the internet. If you're trying to remember something that's just a couple of years ago, you can't find it again. Yeah. But I was enjoying Caprica. You know, it was a different type of program. It was addressing issues which are pretty much issues of the day. You know, we've got the influence of different religions within societies, and no religion, and how people, and terrorism, and how people are interacting with each other and going forward. You know, okay, there were a few explosions and bombs, but there wasn't the usual kind of massives of spent cartridges everywhere and people dying in the bucket load for no reason, you know. I was enjoying Caprica, and they canned it. A simple gender equivalence. No, it's deeper than that. It's far deeper than that. You need the right person in the job to empathise with the entire audience. And it's as a result of that, I think, that means I'm not watching TV anymore. You know, I'm not even watching Doctor Who. If I watch any TV at all, it's a couple of films that people have recommended to me, and the news. That's about it. You know? Because the entertainment they're putting out just isn't speaking to me. And it's deeper than just having a man or woman in the role making the decisions. And you could say that, yeah, Streep's argument is actually probably valid with, in that we've already laid the foundations for the next generation. That both men and women are now thinking along the same lines in terms of entertainment. I don't know. You could go for a deeper, much deeper thought than that. When it comes to a lot of these decisions that we're making, some of it is sort of understandable that people would want the black and white in order to make their judgment on people a lot easier, and certainly when it comes down to the toilet argument. I mean, what exactly are people making this decision on? The arguments that I hear are whether or not someone can have children or not, and there are women who can't have children, there are men who can't have children because of biological factors way beyond their control. But no, for some reason, that only applies to the decision making when they want to, when the people doing the arguing want to deliberately find something to attack why transsexual people can't use the opposite toilets, you know? And when I started, when I first crossed over more than 20 years ago, I carried a letter. In case anybody kicked off. You know, but nobody did. Nobody actually kicked off. I mean, I think the majority of people, if anybody was going to kick off on anything, it wasn't going to be a case of how I looked. It was going to be a case of how I acted, you know? If I just go in there, do my business, wash my hands, walk out, nobody's got an issue with that. But if I started behaving oddly, then people would have an issue with it, and people would have an issue with it no matter what the sex, gender, or anything that the person is. It's how the person's behaving, not what they are, and people would take issue with that. And the people making the arguments against are on very shaky ground. Well, that they haven't even got any ground, to be perfectly honest. Not from what I can see. They're deliberately trying to pick arguments which don't actually stand up when you look deeper into them. Because at the end of the day, between my social change and the actual surgery, in my case, was a period of 11 years. And I functioned perfectly well. Nobody really took offense or made a scene at anything, and I think that's because of how I behaved, you know? And if anything, I was my own worst enemy, because I was as nervous as hell, especially in the beginning, and sometimes even now I can get nervous if I'm feeling a bit weak emotionally, because, you know, I don't want to cause a scene. But certainly, you can cause a scene if someone has crossed and they identify as one sex. If they went back into the original, I mean, if a woman in a dress walks into the gents, or a bloke in jeans and t-shirts giving it all the muscles walks into a female toilet, you know, you're gonna get it. But if somebody is actually if I, having crossed, now looking like this, wore jeans, t-shirt, and you know, puffed out my shoulders and walked into a chance, I'd create a scene. Because that's pretty much the first thing. Whoa, woman in the gents, get the hell out of here, you know. You can't win. You're always going to lose. And how do you lose the least? How do you take you've pretty much got to take the road which has the least risk of offending anyone. Now I know that I still worry about offending people, and I can't win. But fortunately, nobody's really taken any offence. And if these people who are raising objections, because at the end of the day, nobody can actually tell what's underneath, not only the clothes, but underneath the skin. You know, Mother Nature mucks around with us in an incredible number of ways. One of the links I'll put in the hoo-ha bar is to the Intersex Society of North America, and there's some statistics there on the various things that that can affect people, and sort of the numbers involved. And when you take the whole position, as many as one, you know, that there is sufficient range between male and female, that there's already quite a range there. And but one in 100 of us are actually outside that range. You know, so when we look at someone, we really are making a shared load of assumptions, and we're running on those assumptions. Nah. Nah. If you want to cause the minimum fuss in society, not only for society in general, but the person concerned, there are things called blocking hormones. Now, if I find it again, because again, it's another one of these things that's a few years old, I'll put the link in the hoo-ha bar to a YouTube video. It's a very good one. I think it was a TEDx conference. And the long story short is the majority of progression through growth is one way, and it reaches common for everyone, and it reaches a point where testosterone or estrogen in sufficient quantities will start altering bone structure, like you're making jaws squarer, starting extra hair, the voice breaking. And if a child identifies, blocking hormones basically put a freeze on that development. It buys time so that the child, parents, everyone can examine that individual case and work out what's best for that child. It buys time. That's the important thing. And they're already doing this in the Netherlands. They've been doing it for some time. They're looking at doing it in the US. Because pretty much, if someone does identify as female and they're about to receive a hit of testosterone, if you can break that, then you will halt the bone structure developments, and that person, as they grow, will have an easier time in society, and society will have an easier time. The blocking hormones make a lot of sense. We've got a lot of conservative idiots in the UK called politicians. That don't want to use that treatment in the UK. They would rather the child grow, wind up with a bone structure which may not suit where their head is at, and they're going to cause that child and society a lot of problems if later on that child decides to change social role. That's how short-sighted our politicians are. You know, they don't care. I think that's one case where the UK is actually behind the US. But yeah, there's. To sum this up, the definition of what is a man and what is a woman is a darn sight more than male or female. Is it, you know? Heads in jars, you can identify a man or a woman. So, a lot of this attempt to pin down to physical characteristics doesn't work. The argument fails completely, totally, and utterly. And the question is that if society really wants things to work smoothly, then it needs to put some effort behind getting people the treatment they need, buy them the time that they need to make the right choice in life as soon as possible. Because the more successfully that someone grows, identifies the person that they are, and if things are done at that stage, at an earlier stage, then it makes life better for that person and society as a whole. And the net result of this is that we're not black and white. No matter how much people want to try and push this, we're not. Humanity isn't that simple. Mother Nature isn't that simple. And the proof is there for that. So we'll have a see what I managed to find and what I managed to put in the hoo-ha bar on this. To people who are calling on the inclusion or exclusion based purely on physical appearance and physical attributes, nah, arguments failed. Forget it. That one is straight out the window. Catch you on the next video, folks. Bye for now.